Hello for me. I'm Sven Ubis from ENRW. I would ask to introduce myself, so I will do it a few seconds later. I will talk today about an analysis of mobile payment fraud. And I will first start with an introduction about the payment systems I want to talk about. There are several payment systems, and we looked at a specific one, WAP billing. And after that, I will present case studies about real payment fraud in the wild we found on several websites. And I will present how it works. And after that, I will present some mitigations and conclusion. So before I begin, a little disclaimer. We did this in a research in a customer project. So there's some, yes? Test. It's better. Okay. So for legal reasons, there's some information I can't disclose and we cannot talk about. But it's not the things are not part of the project. So I also analyzed some companies and products. So nobody can. Do some legal stuff on us and steal our money. So who am I? I'm a security analyst at ENRW. It's a little security company in Heidelberg. I'm mainly performing application and infrastructure assessments, and I'm focusing on web app security and mobile security. There was some few other people involved in the project, so thank you to the four people there. So, and now I want to present how WAP billing works. So you maybe have heard about the word WAP billing, and maybe you think, the system is not in my interest. But the thing is, WAP billing is enabled in all smartphones and all mobile contracts by default. So if you're not set to your mobile network operator, I don't want this. This is enabled by default. And how does it work? It's really, really simple. And we have somebody who want to sell products, and we have here his side, and he sells as some awesome product. I go on the site and with my mobile phone, and I say, "Oh, it's a nice product. I want to buy it." And I click on buy. And then in the next step, the partner you will be redirected to a partner. And this, he says, "Yeah, what do you want to buy? This awesome product?" Yes. No. Okay. Test. And he asks you, "You want to buy this product? So if you want to buy this product, please enter your mobile phone number, and then click on buy for €5, as example. And then you will be redirected to your mobile network operator. This can be, as example, Telekom or Aldi Talk or O2. And he also asks you again, do you want to pay for this product? If you want to pay for this product, enter your ZTAN. You got via SMS. And if you want to buy this product, you enter this TAN number and click on confirm. And you will see the SMS, it's not so readable. And there's also a simpler flow. So if you're in the network from your mobile network operator, so you're using 4G or 3G, then it's a little bit simpler. And you have the site again, this is also a product. You click on buy, will be redirected to partner. And he also asks you again if you want to buy this product. And if you click on this buy, you didn't get an SMS, and you didn't have to enter a TAN. You only have to click and confirm on the side of the mobile network operator. So only as a mobile network operator, only ask you to confirm this forecast, and if you click on this button, it's all done and you will be charged €5 from your mobile phone bill. And normally after that you get an SMS and that you bought this product, and but the seller did get his money at this point, so you only have to make a claim and say I want to buy this product, and go to your mobile network operator, and he says go to the partner and he will give you the money back, and it's very it's not so easy to get the money back. So who's involved in this? Who gets the money? So if you buy a product with this system, you're the customer, and if you buy a product, you pay it by your mobile phone bill. The mobile microcontroller gets the money, and after that he put a little bit in his own pocket and pays the partner. The partner has contracts with every mobile phone operator, and does have this build up the system, and the partner says, okay, if you want to make mobile phone payments with this Wobblelink system to anyone who want to use the system, he can go to him and say, I want to make a contract with you, and then the partner say, use this IP and you can charge mobile phone customers by the mobile phone bill. And then the service provider set up a website and sell products, and maybe use also network to get people on his side. So yes, and in the we did know that in this with the system there's many customers get was frauded, so fraud happened often. There's a huge amount of fraud happened in the past, so we asked about how did this happen, how is it done, and we started with it and looked started our web browser and looked at sites and looked at some shady sites and surfed a little bit around, and we found three different fraud networks that did this fraud. And I talk about fraud networks because this wasn't three sites. It was a huge amount of sites, like a few hundred we found, but we can categorize this in three different networks. So we think there are three operators behind this. And all of these three networks exploiting not vulnerabilities in the infrastructure of the partner or of the mobile network operator, did attack the client. Always the client was the target. And how did they do it? So if we used a current browser, we didn't see any fraud. And then we started to look with our old phones, our old browsers, and seen, okay, we get frauded. We click on the site, like kinox.io, and then a pop-up opens, and this pop-up shows this screenshot on the left, and he says, I do some performance measuring on your phone. And we waited, and then we get an SMS that we charged money for a service, and we didn't click on something. So we looked at the source code of the website, and we've seen it's they are using the same vulnerability category, universal XLS, and it's the same origin bypass. And also we looked who did this fraud. And I've talked about this, who earns the money. So it could be the website with ads who do this fraud because they want to earn money with ads, and they get more money if more products are sold. Or was it the AdWord network? Because the AdWord networks also want to earn much money and want to sell ads that have much revenue to website with ads. Or it can also be the service provider who did the fraud because he want to earn, as we want to get many customers, and if they do this fraud, they always get a poor cross for the product they want to sell. or was it the partner can this also be, or the network operator? But what we always seen is that the service provider was the one who is malicious and who is doing the fraud. It was never the website with S, it was never some website like kinox.io or some porn sites. It was also not the network behind it. It was also not a landing page between the ad network and the service provider. It's always the service provider who sells a product. So, they did exploiting this UXSS not only at the partner side, but also on the neural network operator side, because they have to click on this both buttons we've seen in the first slides. So what is the same origin policy? We have this site, where we store an example as example, and they have this awesome product they want to sell, and this is a site. And it's no problem that he can make any requests to his own site. So he can send a post request to the buy site on mobile store, for example, like in with XML, HTTP requests, or so AJAX requests, or they can use a simple post form as a form with a post request or a link or something. And this they can do arbitrary requests on his own domain. But if they want to try it on another domain, like the domain of the mobile network operator, this didn't work. So if they sent a post request to them, this post request will not send it because post request can change things. So the browser blocks this request, and he cannot send a post request to mobile network operator, for example, to buy the product, to earn money, or to charge the customer to money. So this didn't work. So and what they did, this is also true for if you open a new tab, you can access the content of the open tab if it's in the same origin. But you cannot access the content of the tab not in your same origin, so in another origin, so in the domain of the mobile network operator. So if I want, I can open a tab and from my own domain and say, okay, get me the content of the site, execute the server script in the context of the site. But this didn't work in another domain, so in another origin. I have a simple demo for that to show this. This didn't work. So if an old browser here, it's in Chrome. I think it was version, we will show it in a minute, 43. It's from 2015, sorry. And I have created a demo. It's also online. If you can test it with your current browser, it shouldn't work. So, and I can put in I can put in a URL here and say open page, and then it opens a new tab and opens the page I have put in the URL. So it's a page in the same origin. If I click on get content, I get the content of the site. It's no problem. Should work with every browser. But if I put in here, as example, google.com, and I open this page, so it's loading. If you have some emails, I can try to get the content with normal JavaScript. And it throws back a JavaScript error and says, security error, this action was blocked because it's not the same origin. So this is OK. But if I use an exploit for this, I can run JavaScript on the site. So I can inject JavaScript on the site and it's get executed in the context of the site. So I can do get content as example again. So I see the complete emails the user have, and I can do all things on this website, click buttons, enter pins, enter something, change things. And some things are also, you can also try to do screenshots with a fancy JavaScript API, but it didn't work with any domain. So with some other domain, it's working a little bit better. Yeah, it's not so fast. And you have a screenshot of the site. So you can do everything on the site if you have an UX as exploit. So if the user is locked somewhere in, or if you have somewhere a buy button, you can click it without user interaction. And this kind of things was exploited by all malicious sites. And I've shown this exploit for Chrome version 43, but they have used more than one exploit. They have in total used 7 different exploits. 6 was for Chrome on Android, and 1 was for the stack Android browser. So if you have an old phone where no Chrome is pre-installed and you have this old stack Android browser, this is always vulnerable. So if you use this browser and surf with your mobile phone as a mobile network, you always can exploit this UXS vulnerabilities. Also, if you have an old Chrome browser before 43, there are also newer exploits. I will show this later. But they actively exploited only up to version 43. How does this such kind of exploit works? And if you know some buffer over exploits and read about something about buffer over exploits, you've always seen that they're very complicated, it's very complex to exploit. In buffer overflow today, but also in the past, you have to know many things about the CPU architecture and also how the stack works and some things. But JavaScript exploit are very simple and very easy to understand, and everyone who can understand JavaScript can understand this exploit. And here from an example of this exploit, and it's from the real example, and we have here this frames. It's called frames. It was a tab that was opened, and you have a reference to it. So you open a tab, get this reference, and if you want to access the text or inject JavaScript, the same origin policy says no, that you don't, you cannot do this. But there are several vulnerabilities in the past in Chrome, and one of them was in the IDB key range. And if you call this IDB key range, it's the only function, and use this call operation, and pass the reference of frames to it, and then use a constructor, and then execute it. And this JavaScript will be executed in the context of the different origin. So, and this is all that you need to bypass the same origin policy. So you can pass every JavaScript inside this string, and it will be executed in the origin. So what the exploit does here in this example, they add an event listener on message, and everything that will be passed to this event listener will be evaluated. So what they did inject a code that execute every message that's sent to this tab. What is it? You can with this message event listener, you can pass message between different origins. So this is intended to do communication between different origins. And here we have a more simple exploit. I think it's the shortest exploit I know So it was an exploit for the Stack Android browser, and they used it in all cases that we found, and it's very, very simple. So we have this window open, and if we pass a null byte before the JavaScript operation, the same origin is bypassed, and every JavaScript I put in this SCR is executed also in different origins, not only it's not blocked anymore. So it's very simple, it's only a few characters. And yeah, how did they work from a technical structure? So I said before that they used the same code on different domains. And they also used not only one advertisement network. They used some advertisement network I never heard before, but they're doing this shady pop-up advertisement. If you go on some streaming sites and touch with your finger somewhere on the screen, a tab opens with an advertisement. They use this advertisement networks, but I also used some well-known advertisement network like Google AdWords and AdSense. And for this Google AdWords and AdSense, it's very interesting because you will be redirected to a landing page first. So I've seen this web shops, and when you look at this web shop, can go to some legit website, like some gaming sites had this advertisement online, and you see this Google Werbung, and it says, cool Reefy routers, and you click on it, and you get to a web shop. And if you get to this web shop on the normal desktop browser, it looks like a legit web shop. But if you go to it on the mobile phone, you get the site, and if you click anywhere, it pop-up opens with this site, malicious site. So we think they did this because Google said on this malicious site, no, this site is malicious. We don't want to do advertisement on this site. So they built this legit web shops to have a legit thing for advertisement on Google, so Google cannot detect they're doing malicious stuff. And they're also using multiple partners. So it's for the case one partner says you're doing malicious stuff, we block you. They have another partner, so they can stay online and earn more money. Also, they're doing, we've seen at least for these two networks, we've seen they're doing anonymization. So we didn't find any contact information of the people behind it. They used like Cloudflare as provider for, so we didn't know which are the real servers. We didn't know who owns or who is the owner of the domain. So it's an anonymized domain, and they sometimes do code obfuscation. So one of the networks has code obfuscation, the others not. The others don't care about it. So we have some code we cannot read, and we have to decode it first. And they also used legitimate flows. If you was frauded successfully, you get, when you go on the site again, it's a legit website that's selling this product legitimately. So also, if you have a modern browser which has no exploit or no vulnerability, you get the legitimate flow. So the flow that is intended, that is legal. And if you go to it, you see, okay, I can buy this product, click on buy, and then you browse the product. They must do it because if someone asks you, what do you selling? They have to show this legit site to show, okay, we sell normal products, and everyone who wants to buy it can buy it, and everyone who has buy it wanted to buy it and now says, hey, I don't wanted to buy this. Yeah, and they also we also did take a look at as a organizational structure of the scammer networks, and we found one case, as is the most cases located, this company who earns the money located in USA. It's mostly shelf companies. There's no people, no name behind it. But one of that was a German German UG with we take a look at the Handelsregister Eintrag, so commercial register, and the executive director lived in Las Vegas, and the director who was the director before lived in Romania. The self company, they bought it for 2,500 users, and also we seen code fragmented for other mobile network operators outside from Germany, and also for other companies and services outside from Europe. So we think they're operating international. And one case, as they did not do any anonymization, this was one case, they operated in Germany. We had the name, we found the name of this person who did this fraud, we think did this fraud. And the managers mentioned another online fraud cases. If you remember it in the past, there was this Abu Fallen, where you can go to a website and register, and there was a small line that says you pay 60 euros per month. And they did this, and now they do this. So they changed their, the things, how to fraud the people. So we also thought about looking at mobile malware and mobile malicious ads. And there is there are malicious apps in the wild. And this has to be the worst case, because an app can do arbitrary requests. And you don't need a same region bypass, you don't need a vulnerability, you can do every request to every server he wants. And also a two-factor authentication bypass is possible. If you get an SMS with Nutan, you can simply read the SMS if you have the permission, or if an exploit to read the SMS. And the downside is this is more expensive, and we didn't find any evidence that they're using this at the moment. What they are using in malicious apps are sending SMS to premium numbers or calling premium numbers. And this is how they are doing the fraud with malicious apps at the moment. So what are the mitigations? One mitigations for the customer, it's pretty simple. Using the latest browser version. So current fraud attacks Chrome before version 48, and all Android stack browser, if I'm using a current browser, I'm safe. And the mobile network operator, what can they do? Use SMS tunnel verification for all browsers. Could be a solution, but this is not effective, because we looked at it in the beginning of the year, and we found a recent UXSS for all major mobile platforms. So I looked at it in March, and it was an UXSS in Chrome that patched on January, and also one in WebKit that patched on January, and then also in the Internet Explorer 11 patched in March. And yeah. So what is an effective fraud prevention? Always uses SMS 10 verification. And the mobile network operators, Telefonica, Telecom, and Mobidigital started this at the beginning of the year. So they switched to an to the SMS 10 verification for all customers, not only if you're not in the mobile network. So when you're in the mobile network, you always get SMS 10 before, and you have to enter it to this website. And with a new access, you cannot access SMS, so you cannot enter it. You cannot know this TAN and cannot enter it, and you cannot bypass this security solution. Another things they have to do is security of the core infrastructure they have. If they have malicious, if they have injections in their sites or in APIs for their partners, maybe they can bypass this solution or bypass every security defense. And also, and conditional monitoring of fraud in the world could be effective. So if they're switching to malicious apps and read the SMS and put it in, if you do monitoring of the If you do monitoring, you should see this. What could be mitigations for malicious apps? It's really a problem. They can make error to your HTTPL request. Mostly, they can maybe get the permission to read SMS, or they can exploit the Android version or the version of the current operating mobile operating system and simply read the SMS. So for a customer, yeah, obviously use apps from trusted sources, but when the mobile network operator want to prevent this, the only solution we force came into our mind to use this kind of captures where you put the text, yeah, you will get a subscription for $4.99 per month if you enter this TUN. But it's we didn't see any evidence yet that this happened. Yeah. So I'm coming to the conclusion. So all scams we found used vulnerabilities in clients. We found no evidence for other techniques like malicious apps, or they didn't exploit infrastructure of the mobile network providers or something. And the only party in the chain, was bad guy. So we didn't found any evidence that the partners did fraud, also not the advertisement networks. It was only the service provider who sells the product. It was always a fraud. So, but all parties earn money, so it could be interesting for all parties. And most scammers made afford to hide their identity, so they didn't want to know, be known, and also so then I think they know that they're doing illegal stuff, and the two-factor verification will raise the bar, so it's now it's more complicated to earn money with this wobbling stuff, and so as a cost benefit for an detectable shift, maybe they will stop doing this fraud, maybe they're thinking of new ways to fraud customers using malicious apps, but we didn't find any evidence yet. Yeah. So, thank you. And so, if anyone questions? Yeah. We actually for this one example I thought we found the Facebook profile of the persons, and we tried. We sent in message via Messenger, but they didn't answer. And we also presented the cases to our customers, and the customers was the victims of this fraud. And we didn't hear that they're doing legal stuff against it. They're blocking this fraud when they're getting known it, but I haven't heard about it that they're doing legal stuff. But these are the people who can do legal stuff. Also, if you get frauded, you can also try to do legal stuff. But I never heard any case that was successful. So I never heard any case in the news that there was a successful legal case against it. I think the problem is that they're always in the outside from Germany or outside from Europe. So we only found one German company. All other companies are in USA, and if you want to start legal actions in the USA, it's for normal people, I think, not very easy. Okay. Is anyone else in question?
Well, how possible is public shaming for those guys?
I think the people, the two people we have seen, did not look like they know what they're doing. I think somebody said, "Hey, do you want to get a flight to Germany and have a few days in Germany, and you only have to make a sign somewhere?" And they looked like they don't know what they're doing. So these are not the people who earn the money. I think they could get a little pay euros, and they get, so and yeah. So I don't think that's a good idea to make public shaming. Also, if there are the people behind this, maybe they do get a lawyer and do legal actions against you if you do such things. So they know they're doing illegal stuff. So it's yeah. Any other questions? Yeah, then thank you.